Zhu made his way back to the Victory Equipment Store, which belonged to Chang. It was evident that Chang had not gotten much sleep, as he had been diligently crafting exceptional items from the materials Zhu had previously provided. Chang excitedly informed Zhu about an upcoming auction event he was organizing and extended an invitation for Zhu to attend. Hearing about the event, Zhu mentioned that he had acquired some new materials that could enhance Chang's equipment to another level. Specifically, he was referring to the Wind God Pterosaur's skin, which he had recently obtained with Zhang's team. The scene then shifted to the outer area of the Wild Area Forest, where two teams were engaged in a heated battle over the rights to the Spear Boar corpse. The first team claimed that they had discovered the boar first, but the second team argued that they had saved the first team from being killed by the boar. The first team retorted that they hadn't asked for any assistance. Just as tensions rose, Zhang Shun, a sixth-rank martial artist, intervened and taunted the teams by insinuating that they wanted to steal his kill. Faced with Zhang's impressive rank, the teams quickly backed down. Amidst a commotion, Zhu appeared, laughing at Zhang's peculiar personality of acting as the strongest martial artist in a lower-level team. Zhang casually responded that he was merely bored and decided to take a stroll. Zhu then informed Zhang that their team had put in considerable effort to take down the prey in question, and questioned why Zhang was arguing with them about who killed it. Zhang clarified that he was only joking and had no intention of snatching the kill. He then mentioned that his leader wanted to meet Zhu. As Zhu ventured into the forest, he handed Zhang his contact number. The first team was taken aback by Zhu's influential presence, despite his modest rank as a third-rank martial artist. They speculated that he might be the child of a nobler higher-ranking official, which could explain his aura of authority. Zhu, utilizing his newfound skill of stealth that he had acquired upon reaching level 35, successfully killed a spear boar. Reflecting on his achievement, Zhu remarked that the skill felt reminiscent of its in-game counterpart. However, he believed that if he practiced holding his breath and moving silently, it would resemble true invisibility. Zhu's intended destination was the Black Monkey area, and as he ventured further, he unexpectedly stumbled upon a group of individuals from a company called Red Tripod, who were engaged in harvesting. Warning Zhu that he would meet his demise if he didn't leave, they attempted to deter him. Zhu initially doubted their directions, but after reconfirming his path, he concluded that he was indeed on the correct course. Utilizing his skill of stealth, Zhu skillfully maneuvered past them unnoticed. Continuing his exploration, Zhu came across a formidable martial artist named Zhou Zheng, who was leading a group in a battle against the Black Monkeys. Zhu couldn't help but acknowledge that the presence of a powerful martial artist guarding the harvesters indicated that the Red Tripod Company was not to be taken lightly. Observing the coordinated efforts of the Black Monkeys, Zhu deduced that there must be a Monkey King leading them. After 2 hours of relentless travel, Zhu finally arrived at his destination and even managed to defeat a Black Monkey. This victory further familiarized him with the sensation of stealth. Additionally, Zhu set his sights on breaking through to rank 4. Amidst a cacophony, he employed his stealth ability once again to closely observe the monkeys and their Monkey King. It was then that Zhu noticed a peculiar herb, and he realized why these monkeys were willing to risk their lives to impede people's progress. While the monkeys indulged in their feast, Zhu relied on his impeccable stealth skills to stealthily navigate through the area where the Monkey King resided. Suddenly, one of the mischievous monkeys snatched a fruit from its unsuspecting companion, and they all started sprinting towards Zhu. Swift and nimble, Zhu managed to evade the first monkey's pursuit. However, the aggrieved monkey leaped in pursuit of the thief, only to find Zhu standing directly in its path. With lightning-fast reflexes, Zhu narrowly evaded the monkey's lunge. Seizing the opportunity, Zhu swiftly made his way to the tree where the Monkey King held court, undetected. He skillfully ascended the tree and counted a total of 7 herbs before successfully pilfering the monkey's coveted fruit. As the monkeys erupted into a frenzy of chaotic screams upon realizing their loss, the king's attention was momentarily diverted. Seizing the moment, Zhu swiftly pocketed the herbs without detection. However, the king soon became aware of Zhu's audacious theft. Fueled by anger, the Monkey King pounded its chest, creating a powerful sound wave that sent the monkeys into a frantic charge towards Zhu's location. Just as Zhu's cooldown skill expired, the Monkey King caught sight of him. Without hesitation, Zhu sprang into action, dashing away in an attempt to escape the oncoming horde of monkeys. Sensing the monkeys closing in, Zhu employed his flash ability to create a greater distance between them. Unfortunately, the Monkey King proved to be remarkably swift and managed to close the gap, effectively blocking Zhu's escape. Meanwhile, The members of the Red Tripod group heard the commotion and recognized the telltale sign of the Monkey King's imminent emergence. Realizing the danger Zhou faced, they swiftly formulated a plan. Utilizing his stealth abilities, Zhou skillfully lured the Monkey King towards the Red Tripod's location. As the tension mounted, an awe-inspiring aura enveloped Zhou, signifying his breakthrough to martial artist rank 4. The martial artists of the Red Tripod were diligently ensuring the safety of the harvesters. Zhou, realizing the urgency of the situation, wasted no time and promptly took his leave, leaving the higher-ranking martial artists to deal with the formidable Monkey King. The scene then shifts to Zhou, the leader, and his friend. They now have the knowledge that Zhou was the one who had stolen their prized Red Viper King on that fateful day. The evidence lies in the fact that the description of Zhou's car matches the one that was parked near their team's vehicle that day. As a brief reminder from part 1, when Zhou was searching for skeleton herbs, he came across a group of martial artists who were engaged in a fierce battle with the Red Viper King. Despite their success in wearing down the creature's health by half and a quarter, Zhou appeared out of nowhere and claimed the kill for himself. Returning to the present actions, Zhao's friend informs him that Zhou Zheng is now a prestigious 10-star member of the Martial Artist Association. Furthermore, Zhou has recently completed the challenging Wind God Pterosaur mission alongside Zhang Xiaokai and other renowned martial artists. This news implies that dealing with Zhou won't be a simple task for Zhao. Filled with anger, Zhao questions if his brother's sacrifices were in vain. However, his friend presents him with a photograph showcasing an organization known as Dark Shadow, which possesses the ability to assassinate their targets. Meanwhile, Zhou conducts a search on the herbs he collected and discovers that they are called blood orchids. He learns that these herbs possess incredible regenerative properties for muscles. Realizing the potential value of these herbs in the hands of someone skilled in medicine making, Zhou contemplates their worth as a priceless treasure. It suddenly dawns on him that the uncle who rented him the motorcycle might possess the knowledge of creating medicines. Zhou had arranged a meeting with him. The uncle was taken aback when he discovered that Zhou was wealthy and remarked on how mysteriously Zhou had brought him to such a place to eat. He sensed that Zhou had ulterior motives. Zhou felt guilty because despite their long acquaintance, he didn't know the uncle's real name. The uncle revealed that he only knew Zhou by his nickname, Crazy Man. Finally, they introduced themselves officially, and the uncle's name turned out to be Wang Zikun. At that moment, Zhou revealed the blood orchid to Uncle Wang, who immediately recognized it. Uncle Wang exclaimed about how it was his first time touching a real blood orchid. He informed Zhou that it could be sold for 1 green crystal at the Martial Artist Association and warned him that it would attract unwanted trouble if others saw it. Zhou learned that Uncle Wang was the CEO of the Sky Medicine Organization before the apocalypse, and he felt a pang of sadness, knowing that Uncle Wang was now just a low-level martial artist unconnected to such matters. Without further delay, Zhou got straight to the point. He asked Wang to meet him not for an appraisal, but to inquire if he would be interested in working together. Zhou knew that Uncle Wang possessed skills in medicine creation and alchemy techniques. Uncle Wang was astonished by the proposition, but ultimately accepted Zhou's offer. However, he questioned Zhou's combat abilities and financial capacity to protect the secret recipe. Zhou assured him not to worry, and they celebrated their agreement. Afterward, Zhou returned home and informed Su Yun and Lan Zai that he was preparing to open a grocery store specializing in selling medicinal equipment. Su Yun expressed her concern about her lack of experience in operating a store, but Lan Zai reassured her, saying she would become more familiar with it over time. Lan Zai promised to protect both Su Yun and the store. Zhou suggested making the store lively and immediately grabbed his phone to call his acquaintances. 5 days later, after establishing the store, Zhou introduced the store manager, Su Yun, and the security guard, Lan Zai, to Uncle Wang. Uncle Wang was worried when he saw Lan Zai's low rank and privately resolved to find an opportunity to talk to Zhou. Suddenly, the leader of the Warhammer group arrived at the store. Uncle Wang remarked that they were quite strong, but still lacked the necessary strength to protect the blood orchid fully. Meanwhile, near the store, a couple of men approached with the intention of collecting protection fees from Zhou. However, their confidence wavered when they witnessed the arrival of Zhang Xiaokai's group, consisting of rank 8 martial artists. Even Uncle Wang was shocked by their presence. It became clear to Wang why Zhou was so confident and courageous enough to open a store. Zhou and his companions rejoiced at the grand opening of Zhou's store. Meanwhile, atop a nearby building, the Dark Shadow Organization observed Zhou's activities. As a quick reminder from Part 1, the Dark Shadow was the same organization Bone Shun's father relied on for protection. One of the members with the codename Shan noted that Zhu was only a rank 4 martial artist and questioned the worth of personally dealing with him. Shan argued that since he had let Zhu escape before, it was imperative to personally eliminate him. After the celebration concluded, Zhu and the leader of the Warhammer faction, along with their members, set out to kill the Monkey King. They believed that if they joined forces while the Monkey King was injured, it would be an easy task. However, upon their arrival, they discovered that someone had arrived before them. This group was engaged in a fierce battle with the Monkey King, and although they struggled, their teamwork was commendable. Xiao, upon seeing them, informed Zhu that they were the War Fox members, recognizable by their yellow uniforms. Zhu realized his miscalculation, as he had intended to snatch the Monkey King away from this group, but it appeared to be more challenging than anticipated. To further complicate matters, another group emerged, this time wearing purple uniforms. The leader of the War Fox members, Yang, reached out to the Inverse Wind Guild for assistance, proposing a banquet and invitation in exchange for their aid. However, the leader of the Inverse Wind Guild, Zhu Yuan Shun, had a different plan in mind to eliminate the War Fox team. He swiftly threw a kunai at Yang, initiating the fight. Zhu Yuan commanded his first team to kill the Monkey King, while the second team followed him. Observing the chaos unfold, Zhu wasted no time. He swiftly dashed towards the ongoing battle. As the first team from the Inverse Wind Guild engaged in combat with the Monkey King, Zhu seized the opportunity and silently eliminated one of their members from behind. With calculated precision, he unleashed a series of strikes, ending the Monkey King's life. Without leaving a trace, Zhu not only killed the Monkey King, but also plundered the crystals in the Monkey King's teeth, which the Martial Artist Association had requested. Realizing that he could no longer escape, Zhu sought refuge behind a tree. The Inverse Wind Guild initiated a search for him, but Zhu was determined to prevent any witnesses, aiming to avoid a situation similar to what happened with Luo Jianyu. In his mind, anyone who caught sight of him must meet their demise. Zhu Yuan and his team were on the lookout for Zhu. Zhu Yuan couldn't help but notice Zhu's remarkable abilities. Zhu could eliminate a martial artist of rank 6 without making a sound and swiftly plunder all of the Monkey King's valuable possessions in a short span of time. It was not something just anyone could do. As Zhu Yuan absorbed this realization, one of his team members informed him that Zhu was only a rank 4 martial artist. Zhu Yuan gestured for silence, pondering the fact that he couldn't even hear Zhu's movements despite being of higher rank. In that very moment, Zhu materialized using his stealth skill, swiftly assassinating one team member and injuring another. Zhu Yuan confronted Zhu, asking him who he was. Zhu retorted, saying they didn't need to know. Zhu Yuan decided to take on the challenge and engaged Zhu. However, in an instant, Zhu vanished and reappeared behind Zhu Yuan, mercilessly slaying him and dealing with the remaining team member. After looting their belongings, Zhu prepared to confront the rest of the team. Meanwhile, the other members of the Inverse Wind Guild managed to eliminate all of the members from the War Fox group. They finally surrounded their leader, Yang, and swiftly executed him. As Xiao observed the War Fox group's demise, Zhu returned and informed Xiao that the Inverse Wind Guild would also face annihilation. Zhu requested support from Xiao's team members and their firearms. As the members of the Inverse Wind Guild grew anxious about their leader's delay, Zhu suddenly appeared before them, brandishing his newly acquired high-conductivity bow. The guild consisted of 5 members. Zhu skillfully shot 3 arrows, instantly eliminating 3 of them. One of the remaining members lunged at Zhu, but Xiao's team members shot at him, obstructing his advance. Zhu expressed his admiration for Xiao and his team's exceptional teamwork. Meanwhile, the Dark Shadow members were preparing to assassinate Zhu. One man, accompanied by Shan, readied his sniper equipment. Eventually, Zhu and the rest emerged from their encounter. Xiao expressed gratitude to Zhu, acknowledging that without his assistance, they wouldn't have been able to acquire such a vast amount of loot. Zhu humbly replied they also did a great teamwork as well. Suddenly, Zhu sensed an impending threat. Reacting swiftly, he employed his flash ability to shield Xiao from a sniper bullet. They swiftly sought refuge among the trees, where Zhu promptly informed Xiao and the others to remain concealed amidst the foliage. He, on the other hand, would venture forth to investigate. With incredible speed, Zhu made his way toward their location. The man accompanying Shan, still regarding Zhu with disdain as a mere rank 4 martial artist, pondered why Shan appeared so frightened. Meanwhile, Shan hid himself on a tree, while Zhu observed the movements of their adversaries. 2 health bars materialized, indicating the presence of 2 individuals. Utilizing his stealth abilities, Zhu skillfully maneuvered himself behind the man accompanying Shan. Through the system, Zhu could discern the man's name and rank. Xiao Jian, a rank 6 martial artist. Zhu then turned his attention to Shan's health bar and was astonished upon discovering his name Liu Yongshan. Memories of their encounter in Wei City flooded Zhu's mind, fueling his anger and resolve to exact revenge on Shang tenfold. However, Zhu had a change of heart and decided not to kill Xiao Jian. In that moment, Xiao Jian sensed the presence of someone nearby. Zhu remarked that dispatching them swiftly would be too merciful, instead, he would derive pleasure from toying with them slowly. Suddenly, Zhu materialized before Jian, feigning ignorance of his presence while subtly taunting him. Enraged, Jian lunged at Zhu with a powerful attack, but Zhu effortlessly evaded it. Seizing the opportunity, Zhu countered with a well-aimed stab at Jian's back. The strike proved critical, depleting Jian's health bar to a mere fraction. Fear engulfed Jian as he pleaded with Zhu, desperately begging for his life. Even Zhu himself was taken aback by the devastating impact of his attack. Shan, witnessing Zhu's prowess in obliterating a rank 6 martial artist, stood in awe. Zhu then addressed Liu Yongshan, remarking on the smallness of the world and the thousands in Wei City, eagerly anticipating his burial alongside them. Zhu then issued a stern warning to Shan, revealing that he was aware of his hiding place. He proceeded to recount a painful memory to Shan, reminding him of the time when Shan had taken his father's life while Zhu was still an apprentice martial artist. Zhu emphasized that despite Shan's current status as a rank 7 martial artist, he, as a rank 4 martial artist, questioned Shan's belief that he was stronger. Zhu believed that there were countless unknowns in the world, some of which would remain mysteries even after death. As Shang descended from the tree, Zhu vanished using his stealth technique. However, Shang couldn't shake off the feeling of being watched. He started cutting down the trees surrounding him, assuming that Zhu had fled. Little did he know that Zhu was patiently waiting for the opportune moment when Shang would become exhausted and careless. Seizing the chance, Zhu executed his flash technique, swiftly followed by a deepening slash aimed at Shang's back. The strike landed, prompting Shang to retaliate with a swing of his sword. Yet, Zhu evaded the attack effortlessly while in mid-air. Capitalizing on the opening, Zhu counterattacked, slashing at Shang's neck. However, the critical blow came when Zhu's dagger pierced Shang's neck, injecting him with the lethal poison of the ghost face spider. In his dying moments, Zhu informed Shang that he knew individuals like him would not provide any valuable information. Nevertheless, Zhu vowed to investigate who had sent them. After the intense confrontation, Zhu and Xiao headed to a nearby noodle restaurant to discuss the spoils they had obtained from their previous mission. Suddenly, Zhu's phone began to ring. It was Wu Chaoyun, the leader of the flashlighting team, contacting Zhu. Wu Chaoyun got straight to the point and informed Zhu that in 4 days' time, the Lightning Flash team would be embarking on a mission to upgrade their team level. The reward for this mission would be a purple crystal and an additional 5% mission bonus. Wu Chaoyun asked Zhu if he was interested in joining them. Meanwhile, at the Martial Artist Association, a boss and his members awaited the completion of Acheng's training. Zhu and his friends had previously clashed with this group upon their arrival in Titan City during Part 1. Acheng revealed that he had fallen in love with Su Yun. Now having reached the rank of Martial Artist 5, Acheng's boss wished to celebrate and ask him what he desired. Acheng confessed that he couldn't forget Su Yun, the girl he had feelings for. At Zhu's store, Zhu shyly handed a flower to Su Yun, and they exchanged bashful smiles. Lan Zai commented that they should spend more time cultivating their skills instead of indulging in romance. Just then, a man entered the store, carrying a bouquet of roses. Curious, Lan Zai asked Zhu why he had purchased so many roses. Zhu coolly responded that it had nothing to do with him. Suddenly, Acheng appeared and declared that the roses were his gift to Miss Su. Su immediately recognized him, and he expressed his aversion to violence, requesting that Su Yun give him some face. In response, Zhu warned Acheng and his group, giving them a mere 3 seconds to leave his store. However, Cheng and his companions considered Zhu's warning as a joke. Zhu's movements were lightning fast as he drew his dagger and pressed it against Cheng's neck. Despite being a formidable rank 4 martial artist, Cheng was shocked by Zhu's speed. Just then, Cheng's boss entered the store and warned Zhu to release Cheng or face the destruction of the establishment. Su Yun cautioned Zhu against acting recklessly, while Lan Zai reminded him that they had initiated the conflict and should focus on finding the Titan Guard team for their arrest. Cheng, feeling arrogant, stated that killing him would only result in Zhu facing the punishment of the Titan Guard team. Ignoring Cheng's words, Zhu tightened his grip on Cheng's neck and pushed the dagger further in. In that tense moment, the leader Zhu of the Titan Guard team appeared with his companion. Cheng pointed out that Zhu must be punished for attempting murder in the street. Zhu's companion, speaking on behalf of the Titan Guard team, urged Zhu to release Cheng, unless he wanted to meet his demise right then and there. Even in his precarious position, Cheng continued to speak in a cocky manner. This infuriated Zhu, who expressed his distaste for being threatened. Zhu complied with their request to release Cheng, but not before inflicting a slight wound on him. However, as Cheng's boss grabbed hold of him, Cheng suddenly collapsed, his life snuffed out. Zhu claimed that Cheng's death was a result of his own actions and not his fault. Cheng's boss, enraged by his subordinate's demise, wanted to engage Zhu in a fight. However, Zhu intervened and ordered him to stand down. Zhu assured Zhu that the matter would end there and not escalate into further bloodshed. Despite Zhu's identity, Zhu emphasized the importance of upholding Titan City's rules and regulations. Cheng's boss was taken aback by Zhu's words. Zhu affirmed that he was not a demon and promised that as long as they didn't cause any more trouble, he wouldn't take lives. Zhu then instructed Cheng's boss and his companions to leave if they wished to avoid a similar fate. After they departed, Zhu extended an invitation to Zhu for a cup of tea, but Zhu declined. The onlookers were astonished to witness the Titan Guard team handling the situation in such a manner, which gave them confidence in the store's protection. They inferred that the equipment inside the store must be of high quality. Excitement filled the air as the customers eagerly vied to make their purchases. With the store bustling with activity, Zhu informed Su Yun that he would be stepping away for a while and entrusted her with its care. In the forest, the man accompanying leader Zhu expressed anger about the earlier events and questioned when the Titan Guard team had become cowards. Zhu responded by asking him to recall the 16th regulation in the dictionary. He went on to explain that a rank 5 martial artist, who was already a 10-star member of the Martial Artist Association, was beyond ordinary rules. This clarified why they were unable to take action against Zhu, as he was a 10-star member. Meanwhile, Cheng's boss, in his car, discussed Zhu with his associates, vowing to show Zhu what was worse than death if he didn't leave the city. Unbeknownst to them, Zhu was tailing them, requesting the old man who had crossed paths with them previously on the outskirts of Titan City to follow their car in exchange for a blue crystal. In the depths of the forest, a formidable band of martial artists successfully vanquished the menacing spear pig. As victory washed over them, Cheng's boss and his entourage emerged from the shadows, berating the triumphant group for daring to defeat his prized combatant. With a smug tone, he demanded recompense for the defeated beast. Hu Zai, a member of the opposing faction, boldly questioned the boss's claim of raising the spear pig. However, a man clad in a vibrant green hoodie silenced Hu Zai with a curt command. He then initiated negotiations with Cheng's boss, offering a meager compensation of white crystals. Cheng's boss, unimpressed by the proposed price for the prized pigskin, contemplated using their lives as payment. Unbeknownst to them, Zhu perched high in a tree, silently observing their tense exchange. Fueled by a desire to protect his allies, Zhu sprang into action, swiftly dismantling their vehicles. Seizing the chaos as an opportunity, the opposing group seized the chance to flee. But before they could escape, Zhu materialized before them, his presence imposing. He scorned their bullying tactics, proposing a more enticing alternative: why not engage with someone on his level? With lightning speed, Zhu dispatched each member of Cheng's boss's team, leaving only the boss and two henchmen standing. Cornered and outnumbered, the boss finally realized Zhu's sabotage had left them without a means of escape. Their surroundings revealed a sinister trap, a ring of fallen leaves, concealing a hidden danger. Desperation flooded the boss's voice as he implored his companions to flee swiftly. Alas, it was too late. Zhu reappeared, swiftly subduing the two remaining henchmen. With his adversaries defeated, the boss acknowledged Zhu's exceptional skill, recognizing him as a formidable martial artist of rank 4. Zhu casually dismissed the praise, stating that he wasn't the first person to recognize his strength. Unfazed, the boss boldly issued a challenge, urging Zhu to engage in a head-on clash. Accepting the challenge without hesitation, Zhu and the boss locked eyes, their confrontation imminent. After a fierce battle that left both combatants weary, Zhu began his journey back, accompanied by the elderly man who had offered him a ride earlier. Curiosity sparked within the old man as he inquired about Zhu's earnings for the day. Zhu nonchalantly replied, deeming it an average haul. Unbeknownst to the old man, Zhu had not only defeated Cheng's boss, but also relieved him of his ill-gotten gains. Suddenly, Zhu's phone pierced the silence, signaling an incoming call from Chang. It served as a reminder of the impending auction. Assuring Chang that he would arrive in time, Zhu prepared himself for the evening's events. As nightfall blanketed the surroundings, Zhu, Su Yun, and Lan Zai made their way to the martial artist center, where the highly anticipated auction was set to commence. Prior to their arrival, Chang had already provided Zhu with a VIP card, granting access to the coveted room 9. Guided by an elegant lady, the trio arrived at their designated VIP room, its opulence and charm captivating Su Yun. As the auction commenced, time passed, and Lan Zai turned to Zhu, inquiring if he intended to participate. Zhu, contemplating his options, admitted that he hadn't yet decided. Soon enough, item 37 took the stage, a peerless dagger, boasting a staggering 35% conduction rate. Instantly captivated by its allure, Zhu swiftly dialed Chang, signaling his intent to acquire this remarkable weapon. However, Zhu wasn't the sole individual interested in acquiring that dagger, there were others willing to purchase it as well. Consequently, they commenced their bidding process. The bidding commenced with a low-rank purple crystal, followed by 1.2 low-rank purple crystals, and then 1.5 low-rank crystals. Chang informed Zhu that he couldn't directly bid on the dagger, since it was being sold by the Star Meteor Company. Therefore, Zhu had to abide by the rules and participate in the bidding. At that moment, even Chang couldn't provide much assistance. However, he did mention that he had a way to help Zhu obtain the dagger. As the bid price escalated to 1 high-rank purple crystal, another individual bid 1.7 higher-rank purple crystals. It appeared that the participants were gradually losing interest in the dagger. Undeterred, Zhu decided to go all in and placed a bid of 2 higher-rank purple crystals. Lan Zai still had doubts about whether Zhu accidentally bid, as later he would be required to pay 10% of the bidding price. The lady responsible for the bidding announced that if no further bids were made, she would close the auction. No one raised the bid, and she concluded the auction. Thus, Zhu successfully acquired the peerless dagger. Zhu expressed his gratitude to Chang for his assistance, but Chang replied that there was no need for thanks. He attributed their success to the wind god Pterosaur's skin that Zhu had provided, which allowed the wind god Pterosaur's armor to be used as the final bid. Upon hearing that the buyer of the peerless dagger was the same person who had provided the wind god Pterosaur's skin, the Star Meteor Company readily agreed to accept installment payments for the dagger. They recognized that the 30% conductivity's life-saving armor was far more valuable than the peerless dagger. However, from Zhu's perspective, a formidable weapon served as the best defense. Afterward, Zhu proceeded to a training room, where he engaged in combat with a rank 7 one-horned dog. He marveled at the peerless dagger's effectiveness, as it effortlessly penetrated the defense of the rank 7 monster. Once Zhu defeated the dog, he left the room. The martial artist who encountered him outside was astonished to see a rank 4 martial artist exiting a rank 7 training room. Zhu contacted the leader, Wu, regarding the upgrade mission they had discussed earlier. He inquired about the meeting location, to which Wu replied that they would gather at Natural House on the outer east main road of Titan City. At the Natural House, Zhu made his arrival and was warmly greeted by Zhang Shun. All the members gathered there were martial artists ranging from rank 7 to rank 8. This time, Zhu decided not to use his real name and instead introduced himself as Gao Xu. The leader, Wu, welcomed Zhu, and they began discussing their mission. Wu expressed his gratitude to everyone for joining the Lightning Team to complete the mission of upgrading their levels. Wu proceeded to introduce the mission to the team. The first public hospital in Yi City possessed a multitude of medical tools and supplies. The Martial Artist Association had requested them to acquire at least 3 sets of these supplies in order for the mission to be considered a success. One of the members noticed the mission's difficulty was significantly high. Wu confirmed that it was indeed an abyss rank mission. The Martial Artist Association categorized missions into 4 different ranks: normal, elite, abyss, and hell. This abyss mission was equivalent in difficulty to the wind god Pterosaur mission Zhu had previously undertaken. Some members expressed their fear and hesitation towards accepting this mission. In order to boost their morale, Wu informed them that only 3 abyss missions had been completed thus far. Once they accomplished this mission, their contributions would be sufficient to elevate everyone to the status of a 10-star member. Tu Fu, a robust individual, showed no fear and agreed to participate for the sake of becoming a 10-star member. He scorned those who were cowardly and suggested they go home and sleep instead. Tu Fu was upset that these individuals had benefited from Wu's leadership, but now they were hesitant when faced with a challenging mission. Wu attempted to defuse the situation by respecting everyone's choice. Tu Fu then approached Zhu and asked if he dared to undertake the mission. Zhu replied affirmatively, stating that he had already committed to it when he spoke to leader Wu, and he couldn't change his words so easily. Tu Fu was pleased to hear this and patted Zhu's back, declaring that from that moment on, they were brothers. He assured Zhu that if anyone in Titan City dared to bully him, Tu Fu would crush their brain. Zhu couldn't help but wonder why he always seemed to attract friends like Tu Fu. After settling everything, they gathered their equipment and headed towards Yi City in their cars. Upon their arrival, Wu relayed the message that they would proceed on foot from that point onward. They would establish a temporary base at the Yi City's Bureau of Land and Resources, which they would also clear out. Tu Fu, aware of the multitude of poison zombies, instructed Zhu to stick close to him. As Tu Fu dealt with the zombies, Zhu took the opportunity to reveal his true name, Zhou Zheng, instead of Gao Xu. Tu Fu was momentarily distracted by Zhu's revelation, allowing a zombie to sneak up behind him. In a swift motion, Zhu saved Tu Fu by shooting an accurate arrow. Tu Fu forgave Zhu, grateful for his rescue. Upon reaching a certain area, their leader, Wu, called for a break before continuing their journey in 10 minutes. Wei Heng, while cleaning his sword, warned Zhu of the presence of mutated poison zombies ahead. He emphasized that the mission wouldn't be as easy as before and questioned Zhu's determination to accompany them. Wei implied that entering as a rank 4 martial artist would be suicidal and expressed concern that Zhu would burden the group. Tu Fu grew angry at Wei, arguing that not everyone could earn the same amount of money and calling him a coward. As they pressed forward, Zhu intervened, assuring Tu Fu that Wei's concerns were valid and that he didn't need to fight for Zhu's sake. Zhu stated that if he wasn't worried about the mission's success, he would have taught Wei a lesson. 10 minutes later, they resumed their journey, leaping across rooftops. Tu Fu was surprised by Zhu's ability to keep up with such speed. Suddenly, some buildings began to explode, and their leader informed them of a high-level poison zombie in their vicinity. Just then, a colossal dragon soared above them. It was the same dragon that Zhu and his friends had encountered during their helicopter escape in Part 1. The group was terrified as they realized its level was at least rank 10. Below them lay Yi City's top public hospital, along with a green-scale poison zombie. Wei noted that the green-scale zombie moved slowly, presenting a high chance of dropping a purple crystal, but its defense was formidable. Curious about the zombie's speed, Zhu questioned Wu. The leader confirmed that although the zombie possessed strong scales for defense, its mobility was restricted. Upon hearing this, Zhu made up his mind to eliminate the creature. The others began to question his sanity, but Wei pointed out that Zhu's archery skills would be ineffective against a zombie's defense. Zhu agreed and reassured them that he still had his daggers. Leader Wu noticed Zhu's exceptional dagger and deduced that he had been the one to bid for it. Wei remarked that even with a powerful weapon, a rank 4 martial artist challenging a rank 9 king poison zombie was a death wish. Undeterred, Zhu assured them of his confidence in defeating the green scale zombie alone, requesting everyone's help in clearing the surrounding poison zombies. Tu Fu trusted Zhu, and the rest followed suit, placing their faith in him. And thus, Zhu rose to his feet, issuing a challenge to the monstrous green scale zombie. With lightning-like speed, he embarked on his path towards the green undead creature. Along the way, he skillfully dispatched other zombies that crossed his path. The green zombie finally took notice of Zhu and launched an attack, but Zhu deftly evaded it. While still airborne, the zombie attempted another assault, yet Zhu swiftly countered the attack. In that moment, he realized the formidable defense of the zombie. However, armed with his new peerless dagger, Zhu could pierce through its defenses. Meanwhile, the rest of the group was diligently dispatching the surrounding zombies. Tu Fu commented on Zhu's remarkable agility, but Wei Yu pointed out that agility alone was useless without the ability to inflict damage. For 2 straight hours, the group battled the horde of zombies, with Zhu engaged in a fierce duel against the green monster. Exhaustion began to take its toll on the group. Wei Yu expressed concern that Zhu's relentless pursuit of the green zombie was leading them all to their doom, accusing him of harboring reckless thoughts. Furthermore, Zhu had yet to inflict any noticeable damage on the poisonous zombie, raising doubts about his capabilities within the group. However, the tides began to turn as the green zombie started showing signs of fatigue, vomiting uncontrollably. The group persevered in their fight against the horde, and Zhu gradually chipped away at the green zombie's health, albeit at a slow pace. Realizing that their endurance was waning, Zhu devised a new strategy. He started running, intentionally provoking the zombie to chase after him. Zhu leaped over a nearby building, leaving the zombie trapped behind. Seizing the opportunity, Zhu called upon Tu Fu for assistance, instructing him to strike at the zombie's legs. Tu Fu faithfully carried out Zhu's orders, and for the next 30 minutes, they continued this method relentlessly. Eventually, the green zombie became immobilized, having lost a limb and a significant portion of its health bar. Zhu seized the moment and delivered the final blow, reaching level 39 in the process. The group rejoiced at Zhu's triumph, aware that without him, they would not have emerged victorious against a poisonous zombie. As nightfall approached, they sought refuge inside the hospital, where they discovered a purple crystal and scales amidst the zombie's remains. Curious about Wei Yu's elation, the leader Wu questioned his happiness. Wei Yu explained that they owed their success to Zhu's indispensable contributions. Zhu humbly acknowledged his role, considering it his duty. Tu Fu commended Zhu for concealing his true power and outsmarting their foe. In response, Leader Wu advised the group not to become overly exuberant and emphasized the importance of resting early that night. He volunteered to stand guard alongside Zhang Xiao, ensuring their safety. In the dead of night, while everyone else slumbered, Wei Yu awoke and embarked on a solitary journey. As he made his way towards the exit, the vigilant leader, who stood guard, questioned Wei Yu's intentions. Curiously, he inquired where Wei Yu was headed. Quick-wittedly, Wei Yu replied that he needed to use the restroom, but in truth, his destination lay within another chamber of the hospital. It was there that he discreetly planted a capsule capable of summoning the relentless horde of zombies. Sneeringly, he muttered about the incompetence of his comrades, Liu Yongshan and Xiao Jian, who had failed to eliminate the formidable Zhu. Wei Yu, however, harbored no such doubts and believed he could succeed. As morning dawned, the group found themselves within the confines of the hospital, desperately seeking medical supplies from the injection room amidst the chaos of the undead. Upon venturing outside to load their vehicles with the much-needed tools, they were startled to discover a throng of zombies surrounding them. Little did they know that this predicament was orchestrated by Wei Yu's cleverly placed capsule. The relentless zombies impeded their progress, rendering their escape impossible. Eventually, they sought refuge on the hospital's rooftop, where the leader, Wu, burdened by guilt, took responsibility for leading everyone into this dire situation. Tu Fu, attempting to lift Wu's spirits, reminded him that they had willingly embarked on this perilous journey. In the midst of despair, Wei Yu interjected, questioning the options available to them and whether they should rely on Zhu to save them. To their surprise, Zhu claimed to have a plan to extricate themselves from their dire circumstances. He proposed procuring a helicopter and returning to rescue them. Fortunately, there was an aerial crane nearby that could serve their purpose. Zhu implored his comrades to place their trust in him. In response, Wu informed Zhu that the aerial crane was situated 5 kilometers away, its path obstructed by hordes of zombies. He queried whether Zhu possessed the skills to operate it. Undeterred, Zhu asserted his capability, having already acquired helicopter piloting knowledge from Butler Su Yun. Tu Fu sought reassurance, prompting Zhu to declare a 70% chance of success. With resolute determination, Zhu embarked on his mission, urging his comrades not to lose hope during his absence. He promised to return. Wei Heng, however, expressed skepticism, questioning whether Zhu would abandon them and flee. Frustrated by Wei Heng's arrogant remarks, Wu issued a stern reprimand, announcing that once their mission concluded, Wei Heng would be dismissed from the lightning team. Nonchalantly, Wei Yu accepted his fate, declaring his immediate departure. He leaped onto an adjacent building, where he had concealed his wingsuit. Donning the suit, he remarked on his lack of time to waste accompanying them. Meanwhile, the poisonous zombies began ascending towards the rooftop, leaving the group with no alternative but to confront them until Zhu's arrival. Unbeknownst to the rest, Zhu adeptly navigated his way towards the helicopter, utilizing his stealth skills. Zhu approached the area near the aerial crane, there were fewer zombies in front, allowing him to proceed. Suddenly, he came across a formidable adversary known as Black Armor Rat, a rank 7 creature that excelled at slicing through zombies. As more zombies emerged, attacking the rat, it effortlessly dispatched them with its sharp tails. Zhu quickly recognized it as the poison zombie's natural enemy. He decided to continue on his way without provoking the rat, but to his surprise, the rat immediately launched an attack on Zhu. Despite being in stealth mode, Zhu realized that the rat could sense his presence. Coming out of stealth, he pondered how the rat had detected him. Then it dawned on him the poison zombie's bloodstain on his arm from their earlier encounter. That explained why the rat was able to sense him. The rat attacked once more, but Zhu leaped into the air, countering with a technique called deboning. However, the rat seemed unaffected, thanks to its robust defense. Zhu knew it would take him at least 10 minutes to defeat the rat, but unfortunately, he couldn't afford to spend that much time, as his group was in immediate danger. He swiftly wiped off the bloodstain on his arm and evaded the rat's next assault. Immediately, he activated stealth mode again and continued towards the aerial crane. Zhu reached the crane and grabbed the gas canister to refuel the helicopter. The zombies in the vicinity noticed his presence and started converging on him. Inside the helicopter, he encountered a complex control panel that differed from what Su Yun had taught him. Nevertheless, Zhu managed to power it on and took flight towards his allies. The group had been engaged in a relentless battle for 20 minutes straight. Their leader, Wu, reassured them to hold on and trust in Zhu. At that moment, Wei Yu emerged above them, donning a wingsuit. He revealed his true intentions, a greed-driven plot to claim not just one purple crystal, but two medium-ranked purple crystals, by killing Zhu. With a final farewell, Wei Yu launched himself into the air. However, right then, Zhu arrived, just in the nick of time. Wei Yu's surprise was evident as he witnessed Zhu's unexpected comeback. The team was ecstatic to see Zhu arrive with a helicopter, as it provided them with a glimmer of hope. Together, they began pushing back the relentless zombie horde, desperately carving out a path to escape. In a display of resourcefulness, Zhu hurled iron chains at the encroaching undead, momentarily halting their advance. With medical tools hastily loaded into the vehicle, the team embarked on their airborne journey. Tu Fu couldn't contain his excitement and marveled at the extraordinary situation they found themselves in. Wu, the group's leader, reminded everyone that Wei Yu was responsible for the zombie outbreak. Suddenly, to their astonishment, Wei Yu appeared before them, soaring through the sky in a wingsuit. Tu Fu suggested that Zhu draw closer to Wei Yu, enabling him to incapacitate their nemesis. However, Zhu discerned that it was not the opportune moment for such an action. Instead, he accelerated slightly to intercept Wei Yu head-on. Skillfully maneuvering the helicopter's tail, Zhu successfully damaged Wei Yu's wingsuit, causing him to lose balance and begin hurtling towards an area teeming with zombies. Seizing the opportunity, Zhu and the group swiftly materialized. In a decisive move, Zhu shot an arrow that obliterated Wei Yu's wingsuit. Despite the odds, Wei Yu displayed incredible prowess, eliminating the encircling zombies. Once the coast was clear, Zhu and the others regrouped around Wei Yu. To their surprise, Wei Yu disclosed a crucial revelation. His affiliation with the Dark Shadow meant that killing him would lead to dire consequences for the team. Zhu asserted that he still had unfinished business with Wei Yu, implying that his debts needed to be settled. Aware of his imminent demise, Wei Yu launched a desperate all-out attack against Zhu. Zhu effortlessly evaded Wei Yu's assault and retaliated with a skillful backstab maneuver, striking his opponent from behind. Tu Fu stepped forward, poised to deliver the final blow. The team reconvened at the VIP room of the Martial Artist Association, eagerly awaiting news on their mission. One of them expressed his disbelief that he had become a 10-star member of the association. Another team member commented on the tea they were drinking, remarking on its energy. Zhu informed them that the tea was called Meteor and had a limited harvest period of only 3 days each year. Tu Fu asked if Zhu had tried it before, prompting Wu to explain why Zhu introduced himself as Gao Xu, which meant expert in Chinese. Now that they had witnessed Zhu's abilities, they understood why he carried that nickname. There was another reason why he hid his identity. He was already a 10-star member. In the inner workings of the Martial Artist Association, Director Shen discussed Zhu with their leader. Since Zhu met the promotion criteria set by the guild, they decided to promote him according to the regulations. Shen mused about Chu He's reaction when he discovered that the first 11-star member in Titan City wasn't him, but a rank 4 martial artist. The leader expressed a desire to witness Chu He's reaction. They decided to assign Zhu Zheng the red-colored rank and instructed Shen to observe him closely and evaluate his talent and potential during the upcoming missions. It was important to determine if Zhu's success was due to luck or genuine skill. Additionally, Shen was instructed to temporarily conceal Zhu Zheng's image as a means of slight protection, but there was no need to hide his name. Shen returned to the VIP room and shared the news that the completion rate of the Abyss Rank mission was 80%, allowing everyone to be promoted to 10-star members. The team was elated by this announcement. Shen then presented Zhu with his new member card. As Shen departed, he commented on how quickly the Martial Artist Association had gained numerous 10-star martial artists, and how Zhu Zheng was always present during each promotion, despite being a rank 4 martial artist. He expressed concern that Titan City's high-ranking martial artists might not remain idle for long. The next day, Zhu ventured into the forest in search of prey to gain the remaining 95% experience needed to reach level 40. Once he learned the catapult skill at level 40, his grinding effectiveness would increase significantly. Suddenly, he discovered traces of motorcycles, indicating that a group had already arrived. Upon further investigation, he stumbled upon a camp belonging to the Beast King Union, a group of martial artists specialized in taming monsters, known as tamers. Zhu decided not to provoke them. As he continued his exploration, he heard motorcycles chasing deer. Among the riders was a beautiful woman accompanied by her dog. Intrigued, Zhu decided to follow them and observe how the tamers captured pets. The woman retrieved a pink powder from her pocket and dispersed it into the air, causing the deer to weaken and fall. Baishu, her dog, attempted to scare the other deer, but she instructed him not to harm them. She approached one of the deer, assuring it that they meant no harm. At that moment, her guards noticed Zhu and demanded that he leave, as the Beast King Union was hunting in the area. Zhu assured them that he had no ill intentions and merely wanted to learn their hunting techniques. Zhu observed the woman's guards, noting their ranks ranged from 5 to 6. However, he couldn't determine her own rank. The woman introduced herself as Zhang Shai Shan. One of the guards, Wu Dai, questioned Zhu if he was seeking trouble. Zhu was surprised that this woman could hold a higher rank than 8. Zhang Shai intervened, advising Wu Dai to restrain his impulsive remarks. Approaching Zhu, Zhang Shai inquired about his intentions and what he wished to learn from them. Zhu responded, expressing his interest in animals and his desire to learn the art of taming beasts. Zhang Shai then informed him of a simple method involving a particular powder. Curious, Zhu inquired if he could purchase it. Zhang Shai offered him the powder in exchange for one blue crystal. Zhu agreed to the deal. After Zhu departed, Wu Dai questioned Zhang Shai about her sudden sale, as she had never offered the powder even when offered a purple crystal. Zhang Shai replied that it depended on her mood. She added that the powder was only effective against deer horses. Meanwhile, Zhu ventured to another area where a rank 7 mutate rock python lay sleeping. To test the powder's efficacy, Zhu administered it to the python. However, the python's behavior differed from what Zhu had anticipated. Dodging the python's random attacks, Zhu realized he had been deceived by Zhang Shai. It became apparent that the python's erratic attacks were due to the powder's influence. Zhu patiently waited for the python's HP to decrease before delivering the final blow. Coincidentally, a group of martial artists appeared, engaged in slaying some snakes. Their leader donned the life-saving armor previously seen at an auction. One of the group members informed the leader about sounds of a fight nearby, prompting them to investigate. The leader expressed disappointment, mentioning the girl he had recently acquired was killed by an old man. Determined to find a suitable replacement, the leader led the group to the location and discovered the python slain by Zhu. The member deduced that since one person had killed the python, they must be a martial artist of rank 8 or higher. Skeptical, the leader questioned the member's investigation and commented on the unpleasant smell of blood. The member responded, prioritizing the leader's safety during their current training. Thus, they decided to venture to the edge of the red-colored area. At the entrance of the red area, Zhu stood, revealing that he had gained 20% EXP from the rock python. He anticipated encountering more beasts of rank 7 and above in this region. Determined, he ventured deeper into the area. After some time, Zhu found himself engaged in combat with a white monkey. Employing a backstab technique, he swiftly defeated it. Taking a moment to catch his breath and hydrate, Zhu was suddenly attacked by a group of white monkeys, launching fast rocks at him. However, Zhu adeptly evaded all their projectiles. He saw this as an opportunity to train his Marco Dodge, one of the rogue's complex passive skills. The skill relied on the body's instinct to dodge an opponent's attack, gradually leveling up through repeated dodges. Zhu intentionally allowed one rock to strike him, using it to enhance his training. He invited the monkeys to attack him again, confident in his ability to recover using the potions he carried. At the edge of the Crimson Territory, the young master who had placed a bid on the life-saving armor was engaged in a relentless battle against ferocious monsters. His primary objective was to level up, and one of his companions couldn't help but acknowledge the astonishing prowess of his swordsmanship. However, the leader swiftly silenced a praise, emphasizing the importance of focusing on their return. Another member reminded them of their master's instructions, stating that they could only go back once the young master reached rank 7. In response, the young master urged them to swiftly bring forth a few dying beasts for him to vanquish. Meanwhile, Zhu diligently trained his macro dodge, gradually unraveling the mechanics behind the skill. He skillfully evaded a barrage of projectiles unleashed by a group of white monkeys, swiftly retaliating with a blinding flash that annihilated them all in an instant. This feat propelled him to level 40, unlocking a new ability called Boomerang Catapult. With this skill, Zhou could hurl a dagger at his enemies, causing them to bleed upon impact before the dagger returned to his hand. The attack power was amplified by 80%, inflicting 500 additional damage, and the skill had a cooldown of 1 minute. Zhou regarded this skill as an area of effect technique capable of dealing substantial damage, particularly effective against monsters ranked 3 or lower. In the midst of his triumph, another white monkey suddenly emerged. Reacting swiftly, Zhou employed his newfound skill, Boomerang Catapult. After 9 arduous days of grinding, Zhou effortlessly dispatched the white monkeys with his enhanced technique, while also seizing their loot. Acquiring this skill had undeniably elevated his grinding speed. However, his concentration was abruptly shattered when a resounding roar reverberated through the forest, announcing the arrival of a white ape king. Zhou skillfully evaded the king's powerful strike, exhilarated by the presence of such a formidable adversary. Meanwhile, the young master and his comrades made progress through the forest. One of the members expressed his belief that the young master would soon level up. The young master responded, expressing his eagerness to leave, as he found the forest unsettling. Throughout their journey, he had consistently covered his nose with a handkerchief. Suddenly, they stumbled upon Zhou locked in combat with the White Ape King. Astonished by the sight of a rank 5 martial artist engaging the king, just a quick note, guys. In the story, they did not explicitly mention when Zhou reached the rank of martial artist 5. Therefore, it is possible that he achieved this breakthrough during his intensive 9-day grinding session. Kong Shen, the member assigned to guide the young master, informed him of Zhu's impressive rank. Seizing the opportunity, the young master ordered his group to eliminate the White Ape King and assigned 2 members, Fang Kang and Kang Jai, both rank 7 martial artists, to confront Zhou. While Zhou battled, he became aware of their presence and realized that this group had been observing him for some time, waiting for the right moment to strike. Filled with rage, Zhou skillfully dodged their crossbow arrows while in mid-air, swiftly lunging towards them. With precise strikes, he punctured both Fang Kang and Kang Jai's hearts, instantly ending their lives. Landing gracefully, Zhou prepared for his final move. Meanwhile, the young master and his companions valiantly fought against the White Ape King. Taking cover, Zhou closely observed their leader, who donned the illustrious Wind God Pterosaur armor. At last, Zhou identified the one who had bid for the life-saving armor. As soon as the exhausted Ape King was vulnerable, the young master dealt the fatal blow, confirming Zhu's determination to exact revenge tenfold for having his prey snatched away and claiming the coveted life-saving armor for himself. After dealing the final blow, the young master achieved rank 7. He then unleashed a ranged attack, skillfully cutting through a tree, proudly displaying his newfound level. The other members were ecstatic about his accomplishment. The young master informed them that once they returned to Titan City, he would cover all expenses at Hanyun Nightclub. Kong Shen urged everyone to quickly loot the area before heading to see Fang Kang and Tang Jin. To their shock, they discovered both Fang Kang and Tang Jin dead. The young master was astonished that a martial artist of rank 5 could have killed 2 martial artists of rank 7. Kong Shen expressed his concern, instructing the others to protect the young master as they swiftly made their departure. The young master commented on how a rank 5 martial artist had instilled fear in his companions, suggesting that the 2 killed might have underestimated the strength of the beasts. He then declared that they were the Sky River group, and they should not fear people. Meanwhile, Zhou utilized his stealth skill to observe them discreetly as they left. While departing, they discussed Kong Shen's diminishing courage. The others mentioned that if Zhou were to appear, they would teach him a lesson. Unbeknownst to them, Zhou was already in front of Kong Shen, in stealth mode. As Kong Shen continued to speak, Zhou suddenly materialized and killed one of the members, sending panic through the group. Zhou's advancement wasn't significant, though. As night fell, the Sky River group sought refuge in a cave. However, Zhou already knew their hiding spot and intentionally lured monsters to follow him. While the group conversed, Zhou appeared at the entrance, attracting the monsters towards them. He sarcastically stated that it was his gift to them. Utilizing his stealth skill once again, Zhou left them to fend off the monsters while he waited at a safe distance. 3 hours passed before Zhou returned. The group had managed to defeat all the monsters, but they were exhausted. Kong Shen questioned Zhou about his identity, to which Zhou simply replied that he was an ordinary person targeted by the group. Kongshen asked why an ordinary person would cause them trouble, to which Zhu responded portraying himself as the villain by refraining from making it seem like he was the predator, considering they had initiated the attack. The young master emerged and warned Zhu that he had made the Sky River group his enemy. Zhu initially decided to spare their lives, but reconsidered upon seeing their current state. Kongshen threatened Zhu, stating that if he killed them, the higher-ups in Titan City would hunt him down. The young master added that if they dared to attack them, the entire city would be after Zhu, along with his family and friends. Undeterred, Zhu confidently acknowledged the potential danger, but questioned whether they would spare him once they returned to Titan City. Thinking Zhu was afraid, the young master ordered him to disarm and kneel, begging for mercy. He warned Zhu never to appear in Titan City again, and promised to request his father to delay the hunt for a few days. Upon hearing these conditions, Zhu used his skill, Boomerang Catapult, killing all of them. Following the incident, the young master's father, Chu Tianhe, a rank 9 martial artist, grew furious as his son had not returned. He commanded his servant to summon all the other group leaders, sensing something dreadful had happened to his son. After receiving Chu Tianhe's command, both the Red Tripod group and the Sky River group assembled a large number of people and departed from the city. Rumors spread among the people about a level 11 king ranked lizard residing in the red-colored area's vine forest. Meanwhile, at the mission reception room of the Martial Artist Association, Zhu was searching for his next mission. He desired a mission that would swiftly enhance his reputation in Titan City. It's worth mentioning that Zhu had reached level 44 due to previous events. The words of the young master echoed in his mind, reminding him of his current weakness and limited ability to protect himself, his family, and his friends. He believed that attaining pure power and authority was the best way to safeguard them. Suddenly, Zhu noticed a Hell Rank mission, which was the most perilous category within the Martial Artist Association. The mission poster indicated that the Beast King Union, the same group of tamers Zhu had encountered before, was offering the mission. Additionally, the reward for completing the mission was an orange crystal, implying the significant wealth of the Beast King Union. In the outer area of the Vine Forest, a group of martial artists attempted to defeat the lizard. They charged at the creature, hoping to overcome it. Observing their futile efforts, Shang Shai sat on a tree with her dog, Bai Xu, commenting on their foolishness and inevitable demise. Out of nowhere, Zhu appeared before Shang Shai, acknowledging her understanding of hunting. Surprised by his sudden presence, she admitted that she had failed to sense him. Zhu inquired if the purple powder she had given him could be used to tame the lizard. Shang Shai responded that taming a king-ranked creature like the lizard wouldn't be easy. She also revealed that she had forgotten to inform Zhu that the powder was only effective on deer horses. Zhu demanded the return of the blue crystal from the deceitful trader, but Shang Shai pointed out that there were no refunds once an item had been sold. As the group struggled to handle the lizard, Shang Shai asserted that unless the leader of their union refrained from visiting the burial site, he would certainly be able to overpower the reptile. Zhu was unfamiliar with the burial area, prompting Shang Shai to explain that it was a sizable city in the northern direction, comparable in size to Titan City. Suddenly, Shang Shai received a call notifying her that someone had accepted the Hell mission they had posted. She hastily left, instructing the person on the other end of the call to inform their leader immediately. Unbeknownst to Shang Shai, Zhu was the one who had accepted the mission. Since the group was unable to defeat the Lizard King, they decided to return the next day with more people. Observing their departure, Zhu made the decision to take down the creature himself. He engaged in a fierce battle with the Lizard King throughout the night, culminating in the echoing roar of the defeated creature. The following morning, the group returned to find no trace of the Lizard King. In the deserted town, Zhu walked around, inspecting his inventory and contemplating the quality materials he had acquired from defeating the Lizard King. Realizing that it would be challenging to sell all the materials at once, he resolved to slowly sell them off. He then checked his skills screen and discovered that he had reached level 45, unlocking a new skill called Embed Poison. This skill allowed Zhu to apply poison to his dagger, which would last for 1 minute. Each second, it would inflict 100 damage on the target for 5 seconds, with a 20% chance to paralyze the target for 3 seconds. The skill had a cooldown period of 5 minutes. Since the deserted town was infested with zombies, Zhu decided to test the skill on them. As he began applying the poison and observing its effectiveness, a group of martial artists on a nearby roof observed his actions. One of them wielded a sniper rifle, and their leader had one black sclera, while the other is white. The leader informed the group that although Zhu was indeed fast, he was still just a rank 5 martial artist. It became evident that this group was also affiliated with the Dark Shadow organization. Zhou effortlessly dispatched the horde of zombies, swiftly moving from one target to another. As Zhou launched his attacks, a sniper took aim at him, but he managed to dodge the shot. In that moment of vulnerability, a colossal zombie seized the opportunity and delivered a powerful blow, sending Zhou hurtling through a rocky outcrop. It was all part of their boss's plan. Their boss gloated, stating that even if Zhou evaded the sniper's bullet, it would be futile since the high-level zombie had struck him. Whether Zhou survived or not, he would be left crippled and incapable of escaping. One of the group members remarked on their boss's intelligence, contrasting it with the incompetence of previous individuals who had attempted to kill Zhou. They didn't even have to dirty their hands to eliminate the target. The boss then ordered them to depart, acknowledging the difficulty of their situation and the need to find a place to cultivate their skills. Emerging from the wreckage caused by the zombie's attack, Zhou's health points were slightly depleted. He consumed a recovery potion, but his health did not regenerate quickly enough due to his sluggish recovery rate. Frustrated with the assailants' attempts on his life, Zhou realized he needed to leave the area promptly. However, he found himself unable to avoid the groups of zombies and the lurking sniper. As one zombie advanced toward Zhou, he swiftly dispatched it while defiantly shouting, "Bring it on! If you want to kill me, shoot again." In that brief moment, Zhu's breakthrough to rank 6 as a martial artist spurred his injuries to heal slightly faster. The power of the stars strengthened his muscles and accelerated his recovery. Nevertheless, he had sustained a broken bone that would require some time to fully mend. Utilizing his stealth skill, Zhou managed to evade his pursuers and sought refuge in a nearby building. Assessing his situation, he realized that to recover his health at a faster rate, he needed to absorb a substantial amount of star power. Remembering the monkey wine given to him by Zhang, he retrieved it and consumed it without hesitation. While drinking, Zhou acknowledged that although the storage capacity of star power in the monkey wine was suited for a rank 7 martial artist, he couldn't afford to be overly concerned at the moment. Immediately after drinking, Zhou felt his health start to regenerate, and exhaustion overtook him, causing him to fall into a deep sleep. Meanwhile, the group who had attacked Zhou focused on battling monsters to level up their ranks. During their struggle, one of them was caught off guard and attacked from behind by a zombie. The sniper quickly provided cover and warned him to be vigilant. Their boss effortlessly sliced through any zombies that approached him. After dealing with the surrounding threats, the group took a moment to rest and eat, discussing the importance of cultivating their abilities. The boss instructed them to rest for 2 hours before moving to another street. Having fully recovered thanks to the monkey wine, Zhou reflected on how the Snake King's skin he had been wearing couldn't even withstand the zombie's attack. Realizing that he had narrowly escaped death, Zhou made up his mind to seek revenge against those who had launched a sneak attack on him. Determined, he left the hiding place, ready to confront and eliminate his assailants.